As the Luzon-wide enhanced community quarantine nears its third week, Philippine authorities are discussing whether to extend the measure or to gradually lift it. To give us his thoughts on the matter is infectious diseases specialist Dr. Eric Tayag, who joins us on the program. He's a former chief of the National Epidemiology Center of the Department of Health. Good morning, Dr. Tayag, and thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Good morning, Christian.
Okay, good morning, Dr. Tayag. Nice to see you again on the program. I'd like to get your thoughts regarding this this proposal or perhaps expectation and a lot of people that the enhanced community quarantine might be or should be extended from the end in on April 12th. What do you think?
This will be extended, and Christian, with all the information we have regarding its spread in many areas in Luzon, particularly in Metro Manila, we really expect that despite the stay-home policy, that many people are still going out of their homes and that many hospitals are still inundated by volumes of patients seeking care. And so therefore, the flattening the curve is not what we are looking at now, but there's hope that if we continue physical distancing and all the public health measures that are in place, that we will be able to cope with this. But regarding that issue, whether or not we're going to have our regular lives back soon, we just have to wait and persevere more, Christian.
Okay, just to make things clear, because you're still with the Department of Health, your statement might be misconstrued as the position of the DOH. You think that this should be extended? Is that what you're saying?
Okay, based on the data that the Department of Health is sharing to the public, there's no reason why there is a consideration that it will be extended. But whether or not for how long, how many weeks more, or how many months, many experts agree that unless we really stop the spread in many areas, and that the health system will be able to cope with the rush of patients being sent to hospitals, then we will not be certain for the next few weeks that we are really going to lift our enhanced community quarantine.
Now, you headed the National Epidemiology Center for 10 years, meaning you were the country's chief epidemiologist for a decade. Based on the numbers that you're seeing, how long do you think this problem would persist here in the Philippines?
I will not predict, Christian. We have to look at this on a day-to-day basis. It's going to be difficult even for experts to predict when is the best time to leave our enhanced community quarantine. But what is certain is that we should trust and follow what government instructs us to do. We should follow our president. We should follow the interagency task force. We should have our own share. People, families have to stay home. It should begin with us. Nothing that government does right now will help if we ourselves are contributing to the problem. It's going to be difficult. There will be sacrifices. People will be out of work. People cannot go out to public places. We'll be physically distanced to our loved ones, but that is what we hope to cope with at this time. Even if mass testing will be implemented next week, it still carries a lot of difficulties, and so there should be planning. When we find where our cases are, then we may stand a chance of isolating those who are sick, and so therefore we can impose better quarantine measures or isolation.
Okay, I'll go to the mass testing in a bit, but I'd like to ask about this. There have been certain models that were produced by certain experts predicting when, with certain measures, the so-called infection curve would be flattened here in the Philippines. But how do you actually assess the credibility of such models if we don't yet have a full idea of the, let's say, the case infection rate here in the Philippines, and we haven't tested as many people as we would want to?
Well, Christian, it's not more on these models, but what we are able to unravel about this new virus, this new coronavirus. For example, there are studies that show that even asymptomatics can spread a virus. And the pre-symptomatics, those who will get sick eventually, just before they get sick, they can also spread the virus. And those who are sick can spread the virus in their homes and in the hospitals when they visit, consult, or confined in these hospitals. And so therefore, this information will tell us that this model can be out of the radar of their predictions. And more so, that we have to have certain assumptions, for example, for this outbreak to be flattened out, is that there are aggressive government interventions that are happening now. And these aggressive interventions can change the curve. But it also starts with every one of us. Everybody should stay home. I wish we can give a hopeful scenario in the next few weeks, but we really have to have our mindsets that we are here for the long haul. There's no easy solution to this. Each one has to play its part. Even myself, I'm working at home. We have to practice physical distancing, Christian.
Director Tayag, at what point during the community quarantine when we will have a better idea on whether this particular measure is working or not?
Okay. If the mass testing will happen, then we can have added information. But exactly how this is going to be done, mass testing as announced by government, will also play a role in terms of what our sanctions would be in the next few weeks. And so therefore, there's going to be a more sacrifices in the next few weeks. And I hope that when I speak to you now, that I'm not giving you disappointments, but we have to have our feet on the ground. Let's listen carefully to what government says to us, because if we don't have trust in government, if we don't have solidarity, as what WHO has repeatedly called out for across the globe, then we will not have a solution. Even if we gather all the experts are within us. We should stay home. It's going to be difficult for many families, especially in crowded neighborhoods, but each one has to help. We don't think government, we don't think ourselves, we think as Filipinos right now, Christian.
Okay, let's also put things in perspective. From the perspective of an epidemiologist like yourself, when you say mass testing, how massive is mass testing really? Let's put that in perspective, because people might think that, hey, mass testing means each and every Filipino will be tested.
Okay, there's a purpose for doing mass testing. It's to detect cases. It's to identify cases which are really COVID, the positive cases. So there are your usual suspects. You begin in the hospital because the health workers may have been exposed and they don't know it yet. And so it's even recommended that they have to be tested whether or not they have symptoms every 3 days or at least every week. And then those who have been identified as positive cases, then a visit to their homes will consider all the household members as contacts. And so therefore, they are candidates for testing. And then our frontliners, those who are outside, those who keep the neighborhood safe, they can be very good candidates for testing. So mass testing is not the 104 million Filipinos that will be tested, but those who will be suspected highly that they're perhaps infected and their contacts caught a virus. And so therefore, we have to identify them. And when we identify them, we're able to trace their contacts. We're able to quarantine or isolate them if they're sick. And if they need hospital services, we make sure the hospital is ready. There are ventilators, there are ICU beds, there are health providers that are available with their PPE because they have to be protected. And there's a system in communities wherein staying home will not be difficult. So food is rationed, anything that they need. And all the agencies are actually, Christian, working on this. Mm. It's a day-to-day battle. This is war.
Oh. So Director Tayag, the categories would still be very specific. The parameters will be clear. So just because, let's say, I'm a politician, I'm a VIP, I can afford to, let's say, to buy a test kit, if that is even commercially available, I cannot just walk into a hospital and say, I want myself tested. There has to be clear requirements.
Christian, one thing about tests is that it doesn't stand on its own. Even with the results, you need a doctor to provide the diagnosis, because the diagnosis is not based mainly on this test. They have to examine the patient, they have to look at the circumstances so that there is a high degree of suspicion. So you just don't take the test results as is. You have to correlate it with what you see in the patient. And so therefore, making conclusions that the test result is negative or positive and you haven't seen all the clues on your patient is going to be a big mistake. Mm. That's why doctors, physicians, health providers have this added burden on their shoulders, how to interpret these test results, aligning them with what they see in each patient. Mm. So we are actually trying to give this message to the public. If you have access to home testing or you have access to a testing facility, it doesn't come as easy as that. You need a doctor to interpret the results. Okay, there are false positives, there are false negatives, there are advantages for a particular test, especially now that FDA has approved rapid test. Mm. And the UP NIH is introducing their own test, Christian.
Director Tayag, is there a target figure or a ballpark figure that should be the goal, let's say, in terms of mass testing, to give us a better idea or a clearer picture of how much of the population has actually been infected?
It will depend on our capacity to test, the number of testing kits that we have, the area we have to cover, the people who will be doing this test, the occupation of the communities. We have to prepare the communities because some may actually refuse doing a test. And so therefore, we have to really prepare communities. As to the exact number, I cannot imagine how to go about this. But right now, we are informed that the task force has the numbers, they're planning for this. And so therefore, we just have to wait. We have to be very patient. When these tests are done, I am confident that these are done for a very good purpose, to identify those who are sick, those who have may been infected. And so therefore, we can have a very effective quarantine and isolation, especially in health facilities, Christian.
Okay, of course, we also, experts like yourself and those from the other experts have been saying, have been explaining to the public the importance of flattening the infection curve for the to allow the public health system here in the Philippines to accommodate the number of patients and not be overburdened. But as far as ventilators are concerned, how many exactly do we have here in the Philippines?
Okay, I don't have the exact numbers. We're still counting them, but it's not growing in numbers. There are options to actually produce them locally. Many have been very creative at producing practical replacements to these ventilators. But what is important is that hospitals are able to cope with this capacity and that they will have enough ICU beds. It's not just the ventilators, because if you don't have the personnel that actually operate these ventilators, then it's a lost cause. It's not actually the machine and equipment, it's the whole system. And so therefore, when hospitals are designated as COVID hospitals, there should be other hospitals that will be, for example, your default hospitals for non-COVID patients, because it's not only COVID patients that we have to take care. In fact, we're getting many reports that many patients who need dialysis are having difficulties having their 3 times a week dialysis schedules completed. And this is going to be a nightmare, because there are so many Filipinos that require this dialysis services. And this is going to be difficult for other patients as well.
Okay, DOH Director and Dr. Eric Tayag, thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Christian, there's still hope. It's Palm Sunday. Everyone should pray that this ends soon. Thank you.
That's all hope.